there's a few things you want to do before we get into the environmental scan itself. Those of you who were at the workshop on the 31st know that there's a lot of information we're going to move through, and we're going to move through it fairly quickly. We are recording this piece of it because we want this information to be available for folks. It is really, really good information about Pasco County on all fronts, so it will be recorded. Because of that, speakers, I want you to be at the podium here or close by so we can pick it up on the recording. It's the hardest for me to do that. I can't stand podiums, so if I get too far away from it, reel me back in. But some of the things I want to talk about, you can see we're going to cover a lot of the environmental scan piece is going to be in the near future here, like immediate future between now and March 7th, distilled into the common themes, because where we have to go is we have to be able to come back to the board and say, here is what we believe we heard you say you want us to focus on. In the workshop, we sort of had to draw that out ourselves. It didn't go where I thought it needed to on that day. But we do believe we have a pretty good idea of what they want to focus on and what they would be willing to fund. So I'm going to share some of that with you today. But what we're going to have to do is, as we come up with these themes, so example might be solve stormwater issues, solve flooding issues, something along those lines would be the what. In other words, the bottom line, end of all, what is it we're trying to do? Then we need to come back as an organization operationally and say, here are the strategies we recommend to get that done over the next 4 years. This is where we're going to come back to this group and all departments, because the strategies need to come from you. Now, a lot of them you already have in place. You know what you want to do. You know how you need to do it. You'll see a lot of that in the scan here today. But that's really what we need to do. So then the board then decides what of those strategies they want to deploy based on what they are willing to fund. That's really, it doesn't get much more simple than that. To give you an idea of where we are on the new strategic plan, the mission and the values have been confirmed by the board. They love them. They're great. They understand it. It works for us. The vision, they like the vision, but we have pushed them in the direction of defining it for us. If we're going to be Premier, what is Premier? What does it look like? How do you define it? How will we know when we are there? So there's some ideas on the board, and we'll continue to talk with them till we come up with what they agree is going to be a good definition for Premier itself. We know the areas for focusing. They were real clear on these, so we'll present them now. It may drill down to some other stuff as we move forward, but they like what we initially called the four objectives. We are now calling the focus areas. We needed to get there. Sometimes goals and objectives were confused back and forth. So these are the four. These four will stay. So creating a thriving community, improving quality of life, stimulating economic growth, and improving organizational performance. Those continue to be the pillars or the big blocks of where we're moving forward in the next strategic plan. Beneath each of those, what we did hear them say clearly under the thriving community, addressing stormwater issues, and accelerating road projects. Those are two things they were real clear about. Now, what does that mean for you? Well, it means a couple of things. One, if your work in any way is underneath those categories or contributes to those categories, you have a good chance of getting some things done here in this next 4 years. Focus on that. If you're going to put business plan initiatives together, focus on the things the board has already said. These are important to us. We are likely to fund them. See how those dots will connect? So we come back to them. We heard you say you want us to focus on solving this problem. Here are the things we believe we can do to make that happen. Based on this level of funding, here's how we'll move forward. And that's going to be the conversations. Improving quality of life, continue along the lines of public safety. So that's everything from fire rescue to sheriff services to code enforcement to animal services. Anything in that realm of the public safety, they're very, very interested in continuing that moving forward. Parks and libraries, a lot of discussion around parks and libraries with regard to the quality of life. We'll come back to that in a second, but they tended to dive down very quickly into the how to do these things rather than the what. To what end do we do these things? So we're sort of having to lift this back up to those themes, but it is up to us to come back and say, here are the strategies, here's how to achieve your what that you put before us. Around economic growth, optimize building construction services and update the LDC. All over that. Talked a lot about it, a lot of discussions. So a lot of things are in place right now. You've heard today. Very important. As we're doing good things, Tell the good stories. Celebrate the successes. Make sure your folks know that they're doing a great job. Michelle and I were just talking. The distance we've come in the last 4 to 5 years is enormous. It's enormous. We went from sitting in a meeting where no one even knew what their levels of service were to now not only do we know what they are, but we're getting to where we have good measures, we're understanding our business, and we're making great changes to improve things. That's a lot in a short period of time for an organization this big and complex. So that's really, really good. Most everything stays in the improve organizational performance from what they were telling us. With, of course, the overarching focus is customer service, including the measures for that. They were very curious about that. We do need to keep those in front of them. Process improvement is a core to it. And if there's one thing you hear on this whole piece today, funding is going to continue to be an issue. The mandate was find innovative ways to fund what you need to do. So look way outside the box. Look at cooperative and collaborative funding, public-private partnerships, bake sales, lemonade stands, whatever you got to do. But come back with unique ways that maybe we haven't thought about or haven't done. And keeping in mind that just because we've never done it doesn't mean it isn't doable. And I know a lot of that's going on in the organization now. So that was the, if there was a warning in this whole thing from the board, it was that. You come back and say, here's what we want to do, and here's how we're going to fund it, and it's going to be this and this and this, and it's very unique, and it doesn't come out of things like general fund, you're going to get applause for it, okay? So the general focus. Now, environmental scan, we're going to move through all the pieces of it. We're going to move through demographics, land development. Our needs are on infrastructure. As Michelle said, these are needs. They aren't just wants. So a lot of what we had to tell the board is, they have inherited a county that needs a lot of maintenance and a lot of catch-up. It's not their fault, but they're stuck with it and have to make decisions around it. We're going to go through what's happening legislatively that impacts us, the economy, and what our fiscal issues are currently, what our organizational profile looks like, the folks who are going to make this thing turn around. We're going to look at the SWOT analysis, both from the internal side and also when we went out in the community. I will touch a little bit on the annual performance report. We'll talk about technology, and we'll talk about the engagement outside the organization and what the citizen surveys have told us. This then painted the picture for the board. They had all the information they really needed to make informed decisions. So this is what that strategic plan piece next that we have to get them to. What I will mention is that this PowerPoint is online. It is in the inside PASCO. It is under the performance development team folder, category 2, strategic planning. So this PowerPoint you're seeing today is in there. The annual report is on the main website. If you go to government administration reports and studies, you'll see that the annual report is in there, and you could print off a PDF copy if you'd like that too. The one thing I do want to mention is our timeline is super, super tight. We've already done what we need to initially with the board. They're expecting us now on March 7th to come back with a draft plan. Now, it will be big blocks, the focus areas and the strategies we're recommending. Everyone here is going to have a piece of that because we're the ones who have to get that work done. We want to make this extremely clear. We want to make it easy for the board to make their decisions around the work that they've prioritized. So we'll be getting with you here really quickly on this because we're going to have to move forward pretty fast. The idea is that we want the board to adopt the plan by May 23rd. And that puts us in line for a couple of things. One, the new county administrator coming in gets the new plan, and the board says, here's our plan, implement it. And two, then we're ready to go October 1 to implement it starting for our fiscal 18. Okay, any questions on any of that? Okay, we're going to roll through this pretty quick. Speakers, you know who you are. Make sure you kind of cue yourself up here because we're going to roll through it pretty quickly, and we're going to start with demographics.
Good morning. Mark wanted me to start. I'm Chris Hughes, for those of you who don't know, Planning and Development Department. We're going to run through very quickly some of the larger context of what we're all working from. As you all know, PASCO, there's a picture of us right there. We are almost 500,000 folks right now, people. By 2040, we're expecting to grow to be about 1 million folks, 916,000 in 1 year, in 40 years. Our county is younger, more mobile and diverse. We have seen an increase largely due to the economy and the economics since 2008. of an increase in rental population, which is a little bit troubling. Our labor force, we have about 400,000 people who are in the age group of 16 or above who are capable of work, theoretically. About 125,000 of those are currently employed. They're largely in the educational services, healthcare, social assistance, and retail. There's a diagram that shows the what I just said verbally. You can see the education is the large bar in the middle. Retail is the second largest one, about two-thirds of the way down. Our unemployment rate, the adjusted unemployment rate was 5.5% in 2015. That has improved slightly. We're a little bit above the state average of 4.9% as of 16. We're at 5.3 now. We're about 10% of families living below the poverty line. And that's better than it was in 2000, where we were at almost 8%. Overall, the population has about 14% of the population below the poverty line in 2015. In 2000, that was almost 11%. Part of that is our aging population. About 9% of those folks are above 65 years of age. Our median income has increased recently. There still are income disparities. The median household income is about, was in 15, was 45,000. And this is a little bit of a shocker. About 53% of our population has a median income less than $50,000. And about a quarter of our population is less than 25,000, and 7% under 10. The majority of the wages, 80% earn below $50,000 annually. So we have a stressed population in terms of income. We need new jobs. We need better high-paying jobs. The cost of living is lower in Pasco County than the United States as in general, and we're 45th in per capita state tax collections in Florida. Pasco is the 51st of 67 counties in per capita property tax levies. We're getting older, folks. Baby boomers are getting towards retirement. It has impacts on us economically. It makes us less flexible. We have less upward mobility in terms of our dollars. And it has social impacts because of the services that that population demands. Commuting pattern is a big issue for us. As you all know, if anybody drives into work this morning, we have traffic congestion. The reason for that is we have people moving out of the county and all over the place driving to get to their jobs. We are actively working through planning to try to get new designs, new patterns of travel that will help reduce trips going forward as we grow. About a quarter of the workforce has a travel time of 45 minutes or more, which is a quality of life issue. Less time for family, less time for community, less time for volunteering, less time for participation in your community. So as we can reduce travel times, we're going to improve quality of life for everybody. Land development. We have about almost 50% of our land is designated as residential development, which is great for those who like to live here. Some of that land, we've got under 20% for agriculture. We've got about 22% for conservation uses. A lot of that is a result of our wells and protection areas. 4% commercial mixed-use office, about 1.5% for employment centers and town centers, which are highly concentrated employment areas, and less than 1.5% for industrial, for light and heavy industrial. Our future land uses, you can see this is a histogram that shows residential at the bottom with the largest percentage all the way up to the top, which is office space, which is one of our targeted industries where we'd like to see a lot more growth. Theoretically, offices bring people who get paid salaries, who have good jobs. This is a diagram, it's a little bit dated, sorry, Richard. This is our market areas in the county. These are the major focus areas for planning activities. You all remember hearing about the Harbors Plan on the west side, which is this fleshy colored area there. We are actively engaged now in the next major market area study, planning activities in the South Market area, which is the whole southern portion of the county. And we've done some work on preservation recently within the last 2 years. We'll be getting to the other areas as well as we move around. And we'll also be doing a major update of the county's comprehensive plan on a regular review cycle, which will involve all of these areas. In 2008, the Urban Land Institute did a study which did a detailed analysis of our plans and what the forecasts were going to be for our market, for our demands for various uses and activities. Currently, the residential, commercial, and industrial, they looked at, determined that about 21 million square feet of retail commercial entitlements have already been entitled. For about 12 million of that 21 million demand or market need. Going forward, they're projecting that we need an additional 9 million of retail space that currently isn't there, an additional 9 million in office space, and just under 15 million of industrial. And surprise, we're over entitled. We've approved more land for residential use than we need, than what our population demands or the market calls for. Interesting thing, supply and demand, when you have more entitlements and less demand, prices and value tend to go down. So it actually affects our revenues per unit going forward. It's an interesting market reality that we're facing at the moment. But it's also one of the reasons people like to move to Pasco. They can get better they can get better quality housing for less money than they can elsewhere in the market. One of the challenges with residential development is that there's a point at which the value of the real estate does not sustain the cost of providing the services to the home. School costs, police protection, utilities costs, all of those things which go into providing services. We did a real quick and dirty with Dan Rizzola. I don't see Dan here. Yeah, there he is, Dan. We came out, I think it was last week, we were at about $141,000 for single family residential value based on our current revenue. That's probably a low number if you look at the whole package, but that's we were trying to get a tease out the actual break-even point in terms of where we had to have revenues coming in higher than the current value.
But Chris, that's for our current level of service.
That would excuse
they
me.
Want a
correct.
Premier level of service.
That's correct.
They need higher level prices.
That those exactly right. Those calculations were done based on our current level of service, not on what we would think we want. Yes.
No.
And part of the issue here is there's policy decisions about what do you approve going forward and what, in terms of finding the continuum of value of house so that you're meeting all the different segments of the market, and how do you as a county in its entirety meet the demand for services across the entire population and the entire spectrum of housing prices. There's a lot of demand in the market by development community to build $300,000 and up homes. There isn't that much market out there, but that's what we're trying to attract into the area. But we still have elderly people, middle-income folks, and based on our population numbers and salaries, we don't have folks that are going to reach that market. So part of this is keeping attractive for bringing people in for new housing and higher wage earners to get our numbers up, but we still have the obligation and concern that we're providing necessary service levels to our existing population and to the growing elderly and senior populations are going to have increased demands. So we would see that break-even point is going to go way high, and whether we're going to meet that or not is going to be a function of balancing expenses and expenditures for services against potential new revenues coming in from growth.
Chris, can we just throw something out real quick here? We have a huge amount of information run through, so these guys are going to be pushing through pretty quick, so we get it on film. If you would, if you have questions, write them down and tag these guys when they're done.
And I'm done.
Next.
Which is the button?
Right. Okay, I'm Mike Garrett, Public Works. And Public Works Department essentially has two divisions. It's got roads and bridges, which is the first part, and then it's got stormwater management. Now, roads and bridges is funded primarily by gas tax. Right now, we maintain about 800 lane miles of what we call collector arterial roadways. These are your major roadways, such as Little Road, Ridge Road, Trinity Boulevard, and such. And we have about 260 lane miles that we think need paving now, right now, at a cost of about $64 million. Now, we have a current level of service of about 32 and a half years to pave all these roads. They're not lasting 32 years. I mean, look at Trinity Boulevard lasted 10 years, and it cost us nearly $3 million of a $5.25 million annual budget to do that road alone. So we're kind of recommending that the board increase the funding for program maintenance by about $10 to $12 million to get us down to 15-16 year cycle on these roads, which is more reasonable. The other roads we maintain are local or residential. We have about 3,000 lane miles of these roads. These roads are paved through a different program, through the paving assessment, or PVAS. I don't know if you're all familiar with that. Most of you have probably been PVAS. But that's where the residents ask us to pave the roads. We send out a vote. If they vote in favor, we pave it. We put it on their tax bill over a period of time, 10 years or so. Right now, we think we got about a $220 million backlog in this type of paving. And we think it's going to take us about 164 years at our annual budget to pave all these roads. Now, obviously, if the road won't last 30 years, it's not going to last 164 years. And so we got a lot of failing roads. Now, a couple things have happened. One, we're talking about, we have, the way paving assessment works is funding was put in for gas tax. We pave roads. We put a lien on people's houses. We used to. Now we actually put on a tax bill. They pay back into that fund. So it's a revolving fund. So we really only pave what's coming back in. So we're recommending that the board put some more money in that fund so we can pave a little more. We're also recommending to go to forced assessments. And the reason for this is twofold. One, we have about 150 roads, I know you're familiar with this, in 2015 that failed during the floods. And by failed, I mean they failed. The base got wet, the garbage trucks came through and literally plowed asphalt roads. They turned them into dirt overnight. The board gave us about $3.5 million to get started paving those roads. And we think we have about $30 million in just that group alone. So we've started to force assess some of those roads, the worst roads, and we're paving them. Now you have force assess because most of those roads failed because they needed to be paved 20 years ago and they failed paving assessment. People wouldn't vote for it. So we're also, so the board agreement is that all of those failed roads are going to be force assessed. And what's going to happen is they gave us $3.5 million, like I said, BP money, BP settlement money, right? And then $1.8 million we just got to do what's called a chip seal on these roads. Our crews have spent the last 2 years working 50, 60 hours a week trying to keep those 150 roads just passable. And because it can't be patched. We're in the process now with the contractor putting down a single chip seal, which is a granite overlaid with tar, so it gets you a good solid waterproof surface. It's not a permanent solution. It's a good solution, travel road, gets my crews off that. But those roads are going to have to, and the board has agreed, all of those roads will be forced assessed. But we're also saying we really need to force assess these other thousands of miles of roads that people are voting no on. Road striping. We maintain about 1,800 miles of road striping. It's the yellow and white striping. I'll go through these fairly quickly. Right now, our level of service is about 36 years. And we'd like to move it down to about 3 years, which is more reasonable. In the lawsuits that we see coming in, they mention road striping, they mention RPMs, the reflectors on the road, and they mention lighting or bad signage as a cause of these wrecks when they try to sue us. So this is very important we do this. Road signage, we maintain about 75,000 signs of various speed limits, stop, all kinds of signs. We replace many of them about every 7 to 10 years. We do that because certain signs have to have a certain reflectivity. The big one is a stop sign. You have to be able to see it. Your lights have to be able to reflect off and you can see it. And that reflectivity degrades over time, especially in Florida. So there's two ways you can deal with that. You can replace them in a set schedule, which protects you from the lawsuits, or you can get a meter and go out and measure the reflectivity of all these signs. But it's cheaper for us just to replace them, so that's what we do. Handrails and guardrails, we don't have an inventory. We don't know how many we have. We find out about them when somebody drives through them, and then we fix them. And like I said, we're budgeted about $100,000 annually is about all we're budgeted. Sidewalks and paved trails. This one's a sorry one. We maintain, we believe, about 115 miles of sidewalks. We're not real sure. That's what we have in inventory. We get sidewalks two ways. One, we build them, or project management builds them. And they're doing a lot, doing 8 miles a year just for penny for Pasco. Or we have a deed for the road. Most of our roads we get through plat where they're dedicated to the public, but some of these roads, they gave us a deed. And the attorney said, if we have a deed, we maintain the sidewalks. So now some of these homeowners associations are finding deeds and saying, hey, you maintain the sidewalk. Good example is Meadow Point, which is found Beardsley, I think, and a couple others where we're going to have to maintain the sidewalks. As a result of those, the board gave us a sidewalk crew this year. It's just a three-person crew, and it's primarily because of places like Meadow Point. But we have to go in, you've got raised edges, but all they'll do is they'll grind those edges where there are trees that have busted a slab. We'll take the tree roots out and we'll pour the slab, but they don't do any new sidewalks. That's all they do. There's just a few. Well, it's called roads and bridges for a reason. We actually have 44 bridges that we maintain. FDOT actually inspects these bridges annually, gives a bridge report, tells us what we have to do to them. We're only able to do small things. If we ever have to do something major to a bridge, we won't have the money or the skills to do it. This is the Stormwater Division. Stormwater Division is funded by the Stormwater Utility. If you own a home, you see a $57 bill every year on it, and that's we charge $57 for every equivalent residential unit. And also charge, if it's non-residential, commercial, we charge $57 for every 2,890 square foot. Right now, we have several areas that with very poor level of service. Drainage wells or roadside swells. These are their ditches along the side of the road, you see. And we have about 3.2 million feet of these things. We're able to clean about 110,000 feet annually with the two crews we've got, which means it's going to take 30 years for me to clean them all. And what that means is you see a lot of these roads that don't have a soil, but they really do have a soil. It's just filled in over the years, and we've never gotten to it. So we proposed to the board to improve that level of service to 10 years. And I'll go through the money a little bit later. Culvert replacement. I'm talking here metal culverts. We have, especially on the west side of the county, a lot of 50, 60-year-old metal culverts. The metal culverts don't have a 50, 60-year lifespan, so they're all failing. And we believe we have about 220,000 feet of those. We're able to replace about 5,000 feet annually with the one crew we have. I don't know. They just finished, I don't know if anybody's around Moog, we just finished a giant one down there on Moog. And they go around and it's very, very difficult work. So what we're proposing there is to increase that, improve the level of service from 47 years to 9 years. So if a culvert's 50 years old now, it only has about a 40-year lifespan, it's not gonna be around in 47 more years. And I think this is probably the primary reason we're getting flooding in these older neighborhoods. These culverts are failed or failing. All right. Culvert cleaning. So the rest of them, we've got metal, we've got plastic, we've got concrete, they all have to be cleaned. And right now with the crews I have, it's going to take me 93 years to clean every culvert we have. That also leads to some flooding, so our proposal has been to improve it to 31 years. Capital is particularly ugly. We spend less than $1 million a year on capital. We have about 312 projects on our capital list, and we've estimated the price at about $300 million, which means that we have the best case scenario, a level of service of 300 plus years. Now the board, don't laugh at it. The board has previously said that we would use the stormwater assessment that we collect to do engineering, design and engineering. But if we were gonna build something, we were gonna create an MSBU, and that's the Municipal Services Benefit Unit. And that's where whoever benefits pays. We have several of those in the county. A good example is Timber Oaks, where we bought the golf course at Timber Oaks. We're going to dig it out and create a giant storage pond, and those people are paying $112 a year for 20 years to pay for it. All right. This year, the board instructed us to submit some projects to the Southwest Florida Water Management District for cooperative funding. We haven't submitted before because we didn't have any money to match, because it's a match system. If you have a $1 million project, they agree to fund it, they'll pay $500,000. They pay it back after you do the work, though. So we submitted 10 projects with a value of about $43 million in those 10 projects. And that first year, we're going to need, actually, the engineering is about $4.5 million for all of them. And the first year, we need $3.5 million for engineering that we don't have, not a dime. And we're going to need $38 million for construction, and we certainly don't have that. So our funding source would be to increase the stormwater assessment for engineering design, and then current board direction would be to create an MSBU. We're going to recommend something different. We're going to recommend a stormwater utility, which is a separate capital utility for ours. So we'd have two utilities, one paid to engineering design and maintenance, and one would pay for capital. To do that, we're going to need to raise the assessment $15 from 57, raise it $15 this year for the engineering alone, and then create the new utility next year at set a rate of $77. Right. So here's the real, well, let's skip one. Okay, I'll go over this. This particular slide shows if we do this, how fast we can get some of this work done. The top one says, if we do what we're doing now, it's going to go down $1 million a year for 300 years. Well, that's not really true anyway, because costs are going up and we keep adding projects. So that line probably going to go up if we don't do anything, not down. And the bottom one assumes we can do $40 million worth of construction a year and Swift Mud's pay for half of it. That's probably not reasonable either. So I'm pretty sure we're somewhere in between in here. And it'll probably take us, if we get this to 15, 20 years to knock all these projects out, which is actually pretty good from 300 years. So on the 21st of this month, we will be going to the board with the rate resolution to increase the stormwater assessment for $23 in one group to pay for maintenance improvements, level of service improvements. So that improves replacing the metal culverts from 47 years to 9, ditch maintenance or swale maintenance from 30 to 10, and culvert cleaning from 93 to 31. We are also going to ask them an additional $15 to pay for the engineering for the cooperative funding project for next year. So we're going to give them a resolution on the 21st setting the rate of $95 for the stormwater utility for this year. That'll be this year. At the same time, we're going to ask them to allow us to create that stormwater utility to collect set the rate at $77 for next year. So in total, we're asking them to set utilities up. They're going to generate about $43 million a year. I think that's it. That's it.